1850s. And there was a very interesting statement from Lord Salisbury, who was the British Prime Minister at the time, saying that we have divided mountains and valleys and rivers and lakes between us as Europeans. The only problem is we do not know where they are. So when you come down to the ground in Africa, they split up so many communities, and you find that you have, for instance, I'd like to relate with our brothers here in Kenya, brothers and sisters, the Samia in eastern Kenya, where your former vice president, Awori, is a half-brother to a Ugandan businessman or politician who's also called Awori. So many communities were cut in between because during the scramble, the borders were created without any consideration of them. So going on from there, what do I mean by quasi? What do I mean by quasi-intellectual property? Briefly, this is talking about traditional knowledge and traditional cultural expressions. And there have been very many definitions of what TK, as I'll quickly call TK and TCEs are. Graham Dutfield, who is quite a researcher in this area, he wrote a report in 2003 in which he defines traditional knowledge as knowledge associated with the environment rather than knowledge related to, for example, artworks, handicrafts, and other cultural works and expressions, which tend to be considered as elements of folklore. So in a way, he's intertwining traditional knowledge and traditional cultural expressions as one. And I would agree that actually traditional knowledge stems from traditional cultural expressions. The way you express yourself is inclusive of your knowledge as a person and as a community. So TK and TCEs are one. And I call them quasi because they are not necessarily intellectual property. Why they are regarded as quasi is because they basically, much as they involve innovation and creativity, like you find in intellectual property, which you can use for socioeconomic development, they're not connected to that individuality in terms of ownership, and they do not have an ascertainable durability, which are basic and essential characteristics of IP. So that makes them quasi. So TK and TCEs are about communal ownership. You know, families owning this or communities owning the other, while IP is about individual ownership, the mind by right as opposed to the hours by right. And one classic example that brings this out quite well is the case of Victor Whitmill versus Warner Brothers Entertainment. In May 2011, Warner Brothers was coming up with a sequel to their movie, Hangover 2. I don't know how many people have watched Hangover or Hangover 2. You probably relate, a very funny comedy. So in both Hangover 1 and Hangover 2, of course, Mike Tyson, the former world heavyweight champion, appears. So to market Hangover 2, they used a poster of Ed Helms, one of the actors in the movie, with the tattoo, which is actually placed on Mike Tyson. Now, Victor Whitmill, a young man from rural base Missouri, is the actual person who did the tattoo on Mike Tyson. And when he did the tattoo, it was agreed between him and Mike Tyson that he'll take ownership of the copyright that comes from the tattoo. So when when they were running the advert of Hangover 2 and it was about to be released, just about a week before it's released, Victor Whitmill files an injunction against Warner Brothers, stopping them from releasing the movie before they pay him for the use of his copyright. That case was eventually settled out of court. Of course, when they say settled out of court, it means he was given some hefty bonus. So we can talk about hefty bonuses. It went on and on, but when I looked at it, Victor Whitman himself, he may own the copyright to the tattoo, but his inspiration comes from the Maori. The Maori community is based in New Zealand. And tattoos are part of that traditional cultural expression. They've been doing this for thousands of years. So yes, the specific expression with the tattoo is his, but what if you find a Maori that has the exact tattoo? That's a one in a million or chance. But you still see the relationship that the Maori wouldn't say that the tattoo is theirs, because as a community they express themselves this way. But the individuality we're seeing here with Victor Whitmill is focused on just that tattoo. So that itself is an example of the difference you're seeing between what is copyrightable and what a copyright is and what a traditional cultural expression is. So how do we deal with quasi-IP? Are there any risks towards exploitation? Of course, they've been exploited for quite a long time because there's no defined structure on how to regulate or how to exploit or how to control quasi-IP. And Gareth Halley, in 1968, in his book, Tragedy of the Commons, said that if property is not well defined, it should be subjected to ill use, and that if no one owns or has an interest in the resource, it will be overused. If you can't define quasi-IP, and if you can't have a structure in place as to how you use it, how we use TCEs and TK, then everyone will be using them because we all own them. They're communally owned, so there's no control. And you won't even say that our kings or chiefs who are the heads of these communities have an ownership. They do not. The culture is ingrained in each and every one of us. If we all have that ownership, then there's misuse likely to come about. So when does the rights issue come in if you say that we all own this quasi-IP? The first thing that we have to understand that with IP, it's easy. With intellectual property, it's easy to understand when the rights come in. Intellectual property is one thing. Intellectual property rights is another. I own the IP, therefore the rights associated with the IP are mine. And therefore, anyone who crosses my path would be ranked a violator, an infringer, or whatever you want to call them. But with quasi-IP, there's a huge challenge. And Susan Scafidi, who wrote a book called Who Owns Culture in 2005, got this quite, she brought it up quite well when she said that who can assert a right to define the normative use of a cultural product, or who may give permission to copy a cultural product. The issue of control does not arise when source community members have exclusive possession of their cultural products and use them in concession manner. Rather, conflict may appear in the case of contested or non-conforming use by source community members, or in the case of any use by non-members. So you have the violators coming in two interesting fronts. We, the community members ourselves, violate our own quasi-IP, or the foreigners, and in this sense, foreigners as people who are not members of our community come in and use the IP. And there are a few classic examples to that effect that I brought out. I placed my examples in different realms, starting with conflicts between countries. Who owns the Agabaza and Gahu traditional drum dances of Ghana, Togo, and Benin? Going back to our understanding of the scramble of Africa, these are three different countries that were split up, communities were split up. But the drum dances are found in all those communities. So they all own them, and then therefore who can take up control of those, then start saying that we're going to have a socio-economic benefit out of this. It is hard to understand. Even going into the Kente cloth designs that are split up between Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, it's hard to know who really owns them and therefore can exercise control over them. Then you have the example of Indonesia and Malaysia. In 2007, Indonesia was threatening to sue Malaysia for the use of a folk song. And the Minister of Culture in Malaysia said that that would be a very difficult case to prove because when you look at the folk song of the Malay Archipelago community, these are spread out between Indonesia and Malaysia. So it would be hard for them to lay a claim over that as their own right. And they spread out not just between those two countries, but even go further into southern Thailand, or Thailand, that is, and Brunei. Then you look at conflicts between individuals and communities. The case of the turmeric, if you haven't known about this before, turmeric is now mainly used as a spice in food, the yellowing powder used in food. But the Indians, or mainly the Middle Asian countries, have been using turmeric for thousands of years to heal wounds. It's taken from a plant or a root tuber to heal wounds. It's a medicinal product that helps. So some years back, some Indian students in Mississippi decided to apply to the US Patent and Trademarks Office for giving them a patent for turmeric. There was not enough due diligence done, which is of course a very difficult case for many patent examiners, and they did get the patent for turmeric in the US. Afterwards, India discovered this and seeks a patent revocation, they get the revocation on the basis that this is traditional knowledge. It's been done for thousands of years in India. But the question is, does India own the traditional knowledge to turmeric? Because when you dig further, you find that this traditional knowledge was exercised in India, in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, in many of these Middle Eastern, Middle East Asian countries. So going further, the Mbube song, which started way, it's also thousands of years old, the Zulu community in the 1860s, this is the latest evidence that comes out when Shaka Zulu passed away, they sang the Mbube song. It's basically talking about the lion sleeps. But then when you fast forward to the 1930s, a young man called Solomon Linda, who was a herdsman, started reciting the Mbube song, and he was the first person to take it to studio. It became such a hit, and the studio people bought it up, exported it to the US, it cuts across all over Europe, it changed its name because they can't pronounce Mbube. At some point it was Mimoe, that Peter Seeger called it. If you remember Mimoe, Mimoe, you've heard that rhyme before. So it ends up in Walt Disney with the Lion King, musical, should I call it musical, the movie Lion King in 1994, with The Lion Sleeps Tonight. And that song alone made over $15 million for Walt Disney. So Solomon Linda, who was the first person to take this to studio, passed away a penniless person in the 50s. His family pursued the rights to this song against Walt Disney because Walt Disney has a presence in South Africa. It was the best company they could sue. Unlike so many other companies, hundreds of which had come up with derivative versions of their song. And they finally settled in 2004 for about $6,000 every time the song is used by Walt Disney. So they are ripping out of it, but the question remains, is it the Linda estate that owns the song, or is it the Zulu community? In any case, how does the Zulu community get anything out of this? Going further on the individual community conflicts, we also have the case of Kuo Yin Nan, who, together with his wife, traversed through France performing a Taiwanese folk song. It was recorded in France without their knowledge, and then later on appeared in a music album, Enigma, Return to Innocence, in 1993. So this song comes from the army people of Taiwan. Kuo Yin Nan sued Nipa. They too settled out of court and received royalties. But the key question was, did they own the original? Because they were just playing out folklore. Another example is that of the Weak Upper Leg or Aboriginal dancers in Australia. They have an annual dance performance which they do as part of their community rituals. And there was a young man, a photographer, who won at one point in time carried out very skillful photographs of their dance performances, and they wound up on stamps, postcards, and everywhere, and calendars. So they too were not happy about this. They took the case to their local council in Australia, and eventually the case ends up in the High Court in Australia, and the court said that what he produced on the materials, lo and behold, he's copyright. The Weak Upper Leg could not understand this because this was going against their social values. They held deeply to the fact that their stuff should not be laid out for the whole public to see. And from that point on, they no longer have these dance performances publicly. You have to be invited for them. Because they didn't understand the divide between corporate ownership and they owning their dance performances. Then of course you have what has happened down here, right at your back door. The Kikoi Saga, 2008 to 2012, when Kenya was fighting a British entrepreneur from trademarking Kikoi. And eventually, the Kenyan government was able to stop this happening. And of course, when you look at Section 49D of the Copyright Act, you have to go through the Kenyan government if you want to use Kenyan folklore. This was a good example of the government coming in to represent communities, and that's one of the arguments fronted in my research, that if communities cannot speak for themselves, which in many cases they cannot, especially they're not legal entities per se, it's the government that would come in and represent them in such matters. But this also raises a big question. Is the Chikoi just for Kenya? And the communities that hold this other folklore also spread into Tanzania as well. Further on, and drawing from what I've just said, you have the Maasai. So the Maasai is more like an East African community. It's just not, it's not purely for one country in East Africa. You notice that the word Maasai has been used as a brand name worldwide. And it's represented in over 80 products in Europe and across the globe. Cars, perfumes, handbags, and so many others have the word Maasai on them. And one person from the Maasai community is called Isaac Oltialolo from the Maasai Intellectual Property Initiative. This was taken from the National Geographic. He says that no permission has ever been sought from the Maasai for the use of their name. But this is used for branded products. Then turning, of course, to what instigated my research, this is a citation of a case before the Copyright Registrar in Uganda in the matter of application number 25 of 2010, where two members of the Ankole community, elders, filed an opposition to copyright registration against President Yoweri Museveni when he sought copyright registration for his You Want Another Rap. Now, interestingly, that judgment came out to the effect that he was not stopping them from using their poems or reciting their poems. He was actually coming up with his own unique expression of his poems. He was not touching the folklore. They're still free to enjoy the folklore. What he came up with was a derivative of that folklore. So the copyright registration went ahead and he got it. So there is a conflict between individuals and individuals. Angelique Kidjo is also another well-known African musician. At one point in time, he copied a folk song and started playing it in studio. And then he was sued all of a sudden by another person called Okupovi Athanase, who said that was copyright infringement. Now, Kidjo's defense in court was that, yes, I've copied word for word, but I've copied word for word of folklore, not your song. But he lost in this case because it was out of a technicality. The court was saying they did not have any evidential rules of procedure on bringing folklore as evidence in court. But the key point to draw out of this was, if you are picking folklore and turning it into a studio production, just like Solomon Linda did, or just like President Museveni did, why would anyone stop you? Why would Athanase have to sue Kidjo for something that he was doing in this respect? No one really owns the folklore, like we say, and it comes from the communities themselves to utilize. So that itself becomes a conflict there. So from all those different conflicts, there are a few recommendations that I suggest on linking the mind by right to the hours by right. And the first is the establishment of a cultural authority that is semi-autonomous in the sense that it's not really a government cultural authority, but it brings together members of government who are the technocrats. It brings together cultural members or cultural leaders who understand their culture very well, and it brings in also people who understand the consumer very well. So these would be the regulators, the administrators, the enforcers, to stop misappropriation, to stop misuse or devaluation of culture. So it serves all those purposes altogether. And it's also important to preserve culture, not to preserve it to the extent that it cannot grow. Culture will always grow. And if you use regulation to stifle that growth, then you're killing it. So if you create a cultural base where you have a database, just like in India, they have the digital database of traditional knowledge. They have utilized that to avoid anything like the turmeric saga coming up again. And the European Patents Office normally even confers with the Indian digital database for prior art before they issue patents. So if you have something of that nature in place, it would serve so many purposes. And within the same realm of preservation of culture, the use of educational institutions for research, primary schools, secondary schools, universities, to research into areas of TCEs and traditional knowledge. which would help in handling the risk of dilution of cultural values and traditional knowledge, basically. With this would help in increasing potential for innovation. If you look at how our forefathers have been doing various things that we regard as traditional knowledge, how can we tap into that ancient knowledge for the purpose of innovation, to bring in our own innovation? Because the Western world has been coming here and doing so much of that research and taking the knowledge away and coming up with essential drugs and medicines. Why can't we do the same from back home here in Uganda? Rather here in East Africa. Okay, further, the need for properly structured legal provisions on quasi-IP. Many of the absence of a structure, just like you've seen in the previous quotation, shows that it's misused. But if you have structured legal provisions in place, that would help us to how we utilize our quasi-IP. One of the best examples comes from Burundi. Before I even get to Burundi, I'll commend Kenya because within the South African community, Kenya is the only country that has traditional knowledge and cultural expression policy in place since 2009. So drawing from that policy, we know that regulation will follow. But with Burundi, their industrial properties law stipulates under Article 260, and I'll quickly read this, that a local community which occupies both parts of the territory of Burundi and part of the territory of a neighboring country may require rights in its traditional knowledge and enforce them in the territory of Burundi in accordance with the law. If the community's traditional knowledge is also protected in the neighboring country, the registration and protection of such knowledge in the territory of Burundi shall not prevent, and I emphasize, this same community from acquiring rights in the same traditional knowledge and enforcing them in the neighboring country in question. So basically, you have a community that is split between different boundaries. How are they going to protect their quasi-IP? They may choose to follow the regulation in one country as opposed to that in another. If there's regulation in only one of those two countries, then that is good for them. If there's regulation in both countries, this provision allows them to decide which of the regulations to follow, to avoid any tug of war between the countries as to how they will protect that traditional knowledge. Try and imagine Kenya and Tanzania, where the Chikoi is a traditional cultural expression. If only one of the countries has a specific legislation to that effect, then we'll go with what Kenya says. If both Tanzania and Kenya have regulation on their TCEs, and the communities that hold on to the Chikoi want them protected, would have to try and decide, are we going to go with Kenya or with the Tanzanian regulation? Beyond just the provision in the Burundi Industrial Properties Act, we look at the Sokokmund Protocol. The Sokokmund Protocol came in place in 2012, and it's architected by the African Regional Intellectual Property Organization. I'm happy that Pierre is here from Aripo. Sokomun is a very good protocol. Sokomun is a place in Namibia. That's where they came up with the protocol from. But there's a weakness I find in section 17.4 of that protocol, which is different from what I've just read from the Burundian legislation. Because here it does not necessarily give you the option of choosing. In any case, in my view, and I could be wrong, it creates potential situation of a tug of war. Because it says that where two or more communities in the same or different countries share the same expression of folklore, the relevant national competent authorities of contracting states and a RIPO office shall register the owners of the rights in those expressions of folklore. So you have two countries, one community, one TCE or traditional knowledge, and we're saying that the competent authorities in both those countries, together with the RIPO, will be the ones to register the owners. What do the communities say here? What if they want to go with one country as opposed to the other? Or what if not both countries have a regulation in place? There may be a situation there that has to be thought through. And those are my points on provoking thoughts as to how we can use our quasi-IP to bring about socioeconomic development. I'll welcome any questions at this stage. Thank you.